Hello, everyone. Today we're going to talk about how we define data structures using lists. So first example, we have following the test-driven development. We will just create some tests and then try to build the code that comes from these tests. So we're going to interpret that those tests. So let me do... So this is a 3D point data type that we want to define using lists, but we want to create basically the constructors and accessors that we talked about in our previous lesson. So let me say user code.record. Okay, I want to say like record. Okay, and now I have again this special thing called require rec unit, where we're loading a module called rec unit, and this is a testing module, just serves for testing. So when you see here in unit, it means unitary test, which is what we're going to do. That's when you're testing like just a single function or a very small functionality. Okay, so we have this code. Let's see if it runs. Okay, first thing it says is that point is not defined, so that would be in line 5, right? So the error I have is here. It says line 5, point unknown, because it says unbound identifier, right? The way we bind identifiers is with define, so we need to define a point. And we can see here that it's a three-dimensional point, we know. So it expects three arguments, right? So we need to define, we're going to define a function, and we're going to do a function definition. So we do point, and then x, y, and z. And we're going to create a list. So how do we create a list? Let's use a list with three elements, the x, the y, and the z. How do we do that? If you remember from our last lesson, we just do list. We write x, y, and z. That's pretty simple. So if I write this, and I run it, now I see that in line 9 I have another unbound identifier. So point question mark has not been created. Okay, so for now, how would we do this? So this is just a function that is checking if something is a point, and this is something you will see in your homework assignment number 1. So that's something that is important for us to define properly. So for now, we don't know how it's written, so let's just do define point, and we see it takes a parameter. I'm going to do point, then p, and then I'm just going to do to do. Okay, if I try to run it, it says that point x is not defined. Okay, so let's try to define point x. Point x also expects, point x is defined here, we know that because of the error message, says line 13. Wait. Line 13 is saying point x. Ah, 15. I added a few lines, so it got confused. Got outdated. Okay. So this is where the error message is. So I'm going to do point xp to do point yp point zp also to do. Now if I run it, I get origin is also not defined, so let's define that. Define origin. This is okay, sorry. So next one is define needs a little capitalization. Okay, and now I have my error. So I've done all my definitions. First thing you might notice is that there's a minus here. And in Racket, we use what is known as the kebab style of casing, which means you separate, you know, like in Java, you have the camel case style to write to join to, you know, when you call a function or a method, it follows the camel case. It should follow the camel case convention. And in racket, it follows the kebab style of casting. So it's low cap, everything lowercase, and then hyphenated. And then, for instance, in Python, usually you should follow the Unix, what do they call it? Oh, snake style. Okay. So we're going to use kebab style because we were writing in racket, and that's the convention. So here, what we wrote was, I'm going to talk just informally. Ideally, maybe we can talk about the test. So let's try to see what each function that we just defined is doing. So the first here, we used point to create a point, and then we check if it's a point, and we see that it should return true, right? Because it is a point. I'm going to talk a bit about how we create that function. And then we notice that point, the result of creating a point has to be a list with 1, 2, 3 by the same order that is created. Okay, so here is actually a quite powerful thing, and maybe we should put this closer together to kind of put these two things together, and then we see that P is indeed a point. So notice a question mark in racket, you can use it, but of course we've been using it in the check equal, right? So after that we have, if you call point X, you get the first component, and if you call Y, you get the second component. If you call Z, point Z, you get the third component. Okay, and finally, we also defined is a given point at the origin. That's what this test is asking, right? So in this case, list 000 would be true, but P is not in the origin, so it should return false. So that's why we're checking for false, and here we're checking for true. Okay, so now we've annotated all the tests. So now we can see that our point should return, when we call point, it should return a list in the same order as the arguments that were given, right? So how do we do that? Well, that's pretty easy. We actually already wrote that code, and if you notice the test case that we're failing, the first one that we fail is this one. So we already passed the first test. Okay? So that's how you would know. You know, I just wrote the implementation, but ideally we would like to look at the code, at the test. So the next thing we want to do is want to check if this is a point. And one thing that you will see as a convention in this course, this kind of function is common, where you have a question mark. And it's also a convention of the standard programming language of racket. So you will see it in your while you look at the manual of the programming language. So if I do a point, basically it's a function that you can give it any value that you want, anything. You could send it a string or whatever, a string, a boolean, an integer, a list, and it should either never crash. So it should always return either true or false, and according to whether or not the thing that you gave is a point. So in this case, we know that a point is a list that has to have three elements. So there are two conditions. First one is this thing a list? And we can use list question mark from the standard library. And then the second thing we want to check is, does it have exactly three elements? And if it does, we're going to consider that to be a point. So how do we check if the length of a list? Well, there's this nice function in the standard library called length. So you do length of P equals 3. And that's how you check it. Okay, so if you want to know the length of a list, you call function length. And if you know if the length is 3, you check if the length equals 3. Okay, the order in which we compare things, of course, matters, right? So if I do this, and I run it, where do you see the tests failing? Line 25. So okay, so we're failing here, so I'm going to comment this out just so we have fewer error messages for the moment, and then I'm going to uncomment it again. So if I run here, I see that I passed my test, right? But we should also be able to, let me add a new test here. So if I do point question mark and I do false, just a boolean, right? No, wait, let me do true. So if you pass any boolean, it should return that it's not a point. It should return false. And more importantly, if I pass a list that does not have three elements, it should also give you an error. So let me pass a list that has zero elements. Okay, so this should also pass. And if I run this code, it passes, right? And one thing that is important to note is that the order in which you check, do these tests, these conditions, does matter, right? Because of short-circuiting. So what we're doing is that if the list, if P is not even a list, we don't even check its length, right? So let's say by mistake, I actually flip this, right? If I were to run this, notice what happens. What happens is that we get an error. Where? You get an error here. Why? Because T is not a list, right? But the first thing we're going to do is actually use it as if it were a list. So length is expecting P to be a list. And because it's not, this function length is expecting a list. Look, it's saying contract violation. I'm expecting a list and you gave me a true, the Boolean true, right? Why? Because we pass through here and true goes here and we evaluate left to right. So first it goes here, which means evaluates this function left to right, which calls the length of P, which is true. So this does not work. So what we need to do, the order is first check if it's a list and then check if the list has a certain length. And this is a pattern you'll be doing in homework one. It's very important to understand this. Okay, and now we're done. We understood how to write a question mark. So next, what we're going to do is we're going to define the accessors correctly. So if we run it, we get, oh, we get to-dos everywhere. Why? Because the way we implement it, point X, Y, and Z, we just return to-do. So if we want to return the elements of the list, we can use this special function called first, second, third, and so on. So I'm going to just use it, go ahead and use it. And third. If you're wondering how do I know these things, well, you should take the time to go through the manual. So if you should just Google racket list and look at the functions that exist. And you can use any in the standard library. Feel free to do so. Okay, so now what we have is to get the X, I get the first element of the list, right? Because here, X, Y, and Z, X is the first, Y is the Z, is the second, and Z is the third. So that's why I wrote this. And there's actually a function called first, second, and third. There's also a function that gets you a position in a, given an index, right? Which, if I'm not mistaken, is called list ref. Let me double check. List ref. Expected a pair. Maybe it's not. I'll figure that out. I don't want to open the browser here, so I'll look at this later and then let you guys know. Okay. Oh, list ref given a pair and return zero. Oh, maybe it's like this. Wait. First ref zero. Not first ref, list ref. Ah, okay. Yeah. So list ref gives you given an index. So you could also alternatively have done. And this would also work. Okay, so I'm going to put these as alternative definitions. But it kind of reads better to just write first, second, and third, right? First, second. Okay. Now I run it, everything is fine. So finally, I want to just check if something... I want to create a new, more test. So this is... Now let's recap and connect these two the code that we've written to the idea of constructors and accessors. As you can see, constructors are things, functions that we use to create values of a certain data structure. So the constructors of a 3D point are, in this case, just point. And the accessors are point X, point Y, and point Z. Right? Okay, so let's imagine I wanted to somehow mutate this list, this three-dimensional point system. So what we would need is a way to change the element, change the either X, Y, or Z, right? I want something that allows me to set the X, set the Y, and set the Z. So let's try to do that. Now I'm going to copy paste this. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to set X, set Y, and set Z, okay? And what I want to do is I want to set Z to be 10, always hit the same value. Now, what I want to do is I would just want to compare that against the expected value. And now I want you to notice a few things. Okay, so now if I try to run this, I get an error. It says that point set X is undefined. So let me copy paste this. Now I run it, and I get a bunch of tests failing with to-do, which is fine. So now let's try to look at the test, and we're going to realize a couple of things. So first thing we notice is that point set returns a list. So it's actually returning the new point. So if we set X, and then set Y, and then set Z, and always use the same variable, we're not actually changing P. We're just creating a new point at each time. So that's why, in the return value of calling point set, you always only change one thing, right? Although you're always using P, this is not mutating P. You get a copy of P back. So when you update X and then you update Y, this is still the same P with the same contents, 1, 2, 3, right? So that's why I'm only setting X to be 10, Y to be 10, and Z to be 10, okay? Because racket is immutable by default, so you can't change an existing value. Once you create a value, it's done. There are ways around this, but we won't learn that in this course because you're probably already familiar with language that allows you to do that. So in this course, what we're gonna learn is how do we create data structures and manipulate them such that we cannot mutate them. We can't change them while they exist. Once they exist, they're already done. So what we need to do is always create a new one. And this idea is known as persistent data structures. They're persistent because their data, their state is always fixed. And what we do is we return a new one whenever we want to mutate. This is the pattern that we want to do. So this is a persistent structure style of updating. Okay. So this is what we have. So what we do now is, okay, so next thing I want to ask you, the second thing, is that these points set, these three versions of points set, they work as constructors, right? Because they are returning a new point. So they are constructing a point. And that's why we call these the constructors of point, along with point, this one. Okay, finally, we're ready to run this. Okay, so now I think we all know what we should be doing, right? Should return a list that has some X, Y, and Z, right? And what is X? Well, we can already use the things that we know from here. So we were going to use point X of P. point y of p, point z of p. Right, but we want to overwrite the x to be the one given in the parameter. Right, so what we want to do is return a new list that has the updated x and then reuses the old y and the old z. That's what we're doing. So let's see if this works. Parenthesis. Okay, so this is important. We got an error, and notice that it's complaining on line 23, which is here. It's complaining because of a missing thing at line 25. So you know, if you get an error like this, you know that you missed the parenthesis between 23 and 25. Right, and in this case, we were missing a parenthesis here. Make sure you use an IDE that allows you to highlight the enclosing or the starting parenthesis. So if you're opening here, it's closing here, and notice that it's highlighted. I hope you can see this in YouTube. Okay, so we wrote this example and we failed. Where? We failed in line 42, so we passed the first test, which is what we wanted. Okay, so now, as you might imagine, the rest of the code is pretty similar. So I'm just going to copy paste it. So we want x here, and here we want y. And finally, here we want z. Now I run it, test pass, which means all these things are correct now. Finally, we are ready to implement origin. So here, what we want to do is we want to check if the x, y, and z components are all zero. So what we can do it either using the accessors or we can compare it directly. But let's do it directly because I'm feeling lazy. So how would we do that? We can do equal. Okay, so notice that I'm just returning equal. Why? Because this is returning a Boolean. I don't need to do a cond or anything like that. I can just return the result of calling equal. So now if I comment this, uncomment this, and save it, and everything passes. So things are working as expected, which is great. So now let's go back to the slides. So we started with this test. We kind of elaborated test a bit and documented. And here in the slides, you can see the constructor, the accessors, and an example of a function. We also talked about how data structures are immutable, and how we can update data structures by creating copies of them. And this pattern is known as persistent data structures. And actually, in the HTML version of this of these slides, you can actually follow this link for the Wikipedia page. Otherwise, just Google persistent data structure. Okay, in the next video, we're going to cover serializing code, what that means. So I hope you enjoyed this one.